It's easy to listen to music today. We have MTV and VH1. There are CDs and live concerts. But 100 years ago, life was very different. There was no radio. Television didn't exist. There were no records, no tapes, no CDs. If you wanted music, you had to make it yourself.
I didn't know about this music when I was a teenager. I was kind of a rock and roll head. I knew about classical music and I knew about, you know, rock and roll.
Norman and Nancy Blake and James Bryan play music that people listened to over 100 years ago.
But I didn't even know this music existed. But when I heard it, I was enthralled because to me it was an American form of string music and I wanted to be an American string musician.
And this is how music was played back then, at home for family and friends.
Well, 100 years ago, music was about the only kind of entertainment you had when you were sitting around the house at night. There was no television, there was no radio, there was no compact disc player, and as a result, you had a choice of either reading a book or making music. And so music was the main form of entertainment that a lot of people had back in those days.
Why do you like to play the old songs?
Those songs, a lot of those old songs were just chronicling the events of the day. And they come from a time when we didn't have the newspapers and the TV, and sometimes the only way to spread the news back in earlier days was to write a song about it.
Oh, freedom, freedom, sweet freedom.
There were other songs that dated back from the Civil War. There was a song called Sally Gooden, which was very, very popular. You still hear it today. In fact, Paul McCartney wrote a kind of takeoff on Sally Gooden, a song called Sally G. But then they also had one that Fiddlin' John Carson, who was Georgia's most famous old-time fiddler, he used to sing a song called Who Bit the Wart Off Grandma's Nose?
Fiddlin' John Carson had the distinction of being able to play the fiddle and sing at the same time. He grew up in North Georgia, where he started playing the violin when he was 10 years old. Later on, John Carson moved to Atlanta.
Then about 1912 or 1913, Atlanta became the center for a movement called the Fiddling Contest Movement. They established a Georgia old-time fiddlers contest and attracted attention from all over the country. And they'd have a really big, humongous fiddling contest, kind of like I'm not sure there's anything I can compare it to today. It'd be kind of like a 1913 version of the Lollapalooza tour or something. Well, John Carson got to where he was winning this contest all the time. People loved him, and he could sing and play all kinds of neat songs. And what they liked about him was that he could sing as well as play the fiddle. And so finally, this led to a recording contract.
Now I'm getting old and feeble, and I cannot work no more.
Many people consider him the first person to make a country music record.
The song Little Old Log Cabin in the Lane was a big hit.
And within 2 or 3 years after that, every major record company was racing into Georgia to get some of this new music that was so hot. They didn't know what to call it. They would eventually call it country music. But at this point, they didn't quite know what it was. They just knew that people liked it. And throughout the 1920s, Atlanta became the center for blues, gospel, and country recording.
In the late 19th century, African Americans played string band music as well. But that would change when a new form of music came along. It was called the blues.
If you could get into a time machine and go back to Georgia and land about 1880 and walk around and look at the kind of music that people were playing, you'd find that there were as many black people playing fiddle and banjo and guitar music as there were white people. What happened is that it tended to die out in the modern days as the blues became more and more popular.
The gal you love is big. Got a letter this morning. Yeah.
We think the blues probably originated ultimately in West Africa, but it was brought here by slaves. It was moved into the kind of songs you heard in the fields, people doing work songs, and eventually these work songs moved into a sort of musical form that we call the blues. By the 1920s, the blues was the hottest thing in American music. Blues was so influential on American music that almost every form of American music was touched by it. And of course, the biggest influence on them was that the blues eventually developed into rock and roll.
I'm gonna get up in the morning. I believe I'll dust my broom.
One of the most famous blues singers was Robert Johnson. He wrote songs like Crossroads Blues and Come Into My Kitchen. Later on in the 1960s and 70s, people like the Rolling Stones recorded Robert Johnson's songs, and Eric Clapton recorded Robert Johnson's songs. And he, as I said, was the most incredible blues guitar player that we know about.
I'm gonna get up in the morning, I believe I'll dust my broom.
Today, both black and white musicians play the blues. William Howes and Jack Pearson play Dust My Broom, a song by Robert Johnson. Blues and other kinds of Southern music have had a big impact on American music.
Some people say that every form of American pop music can be traced back to some kind of Southern music. Rap music is directly related to blues. The kind of gospel music that we have today comes out of the gospel tradition in the churches of the South. Rock and roll comes out of the blues. Country music comes out of the old ballads that were once sung in the mountains and the string band music that were played in the homes. Most of the music that they say is distinctly American music is music that had its roots in the South.
Well, there are still lots of places to see in this state. There are still lots of people I'd like you to meet. This is Georgia Stories. I'm Colin Sedor. Thanks.